Blackstone Publishing presents Kahlil Gibran's Little Book of Wisdom, edited by Neil Douglas Klotz. This book is read by Kevin Kenerly. For those who live their wisdom simply and without words. Introduction. Wisdom, the quality of being wise, especially in relation to the conduct of means and ends, the combination of experience and knowledge with the ability to apply them judiciously. Sound judgment, prudence, practical sense. Kahlil Gibran, renowned for 100 years for his pithy and emotive sayings, the Lebanese-American writer that launched 1,000 or more greeting cards and wall hangings, never stopped searching for the simple wisdom of how to live a happy and fulfilling life. His deeply emotional search created some of his most memorable writing. These new little book collections take a fresh look at Gibran's words, taking into account the major influences in his life, his Middle Eastern culture, nature mysticism, and the Arabic language in which he thought. One could easily argue that what the average reader of Gibran in the 1920s found exotic was the way he clearly expressed a region that most regarded as a mystery. Nearly 100 years later, understanding the Middle Eastern or Southwest Asian conundrum, especially the way that very different cultures consider the meaning and purpose of life, has shifted from being an early 20th century parlor game to become a practical matter of everyday survival. The book before you, the fourth and final in the series, gathers Gibran's words on wisdom for daily life, both in community and solitude. The first book collected his writings on life and nature. The second book focused on love and relationships. And the third, on life's big questions and the secrets of the spiritual path. What is a wise way to live, either in Gibran's time or ours? Does wisdom mean something profound? The province of philosophers, clerics, self-help teachers, psychotherapists, or those with time on their hands to think deep thoughts? Does it mean something subtle, crafty, or devious? The way of the wise investor? Back to the dictionary definition above, what would practical sense mean today, when so much that we consider both practical and sense have radically changed in the past decade or two? What are we all looking for in life anyway? During his short life, he died at age 48, these questions returned again and again to both fascinate and bedevil Gibran. This should not be surprising. Kahlil Gibran's adult life began in outer exile. In 1895, his mother Camila fled poverty and a failed marriage in Lebanon and brought young Kahlil, aged 12, his brother and 2 sisters to live in Boston. Today, they would be called migrants. Yet Gibran's connection to his native land remained strong throughout his life. He saw himself as Syrian culturally. Neither the nations of Syria nor Lebanon existed at the time, and dedicated himself to the liberation of his people from oppressive regimes and systems. During Gibran's youth, political strife engulfed the whole region before, during, and after the First World War. Initially, Gibran had high hopes that the war would dislodge the Ottoman Empire's grip on his homeland. It did this, but Gibran and many others were disappointed by the Sykes-Picot Agreement made by the victorious European and American powers in 1916, before the end of the war, to divide the region into various nation-states for their own benefit. He poignantly depicts his sense of betrayal in a short ironic parable written during the time about a mother sheep and a lamb watching 2 eagles fighting above them to determine which would eat them. The story, entitled War and the Small Nations, ends with the sheep saying to the lamb, "How strange, my child, that these 2 noble birds should attack one another. Is not the vast sky large enough for both of them? Pray, my little one, pray in your heart that God may make peace between your winged brothers." And the lamb prayed in its heart. Many of the selections in this book express Gibran's trenchant and often prescient views on government, organized religion, wealth, and commerce. As he viewed them, all of these institutions express normal human needs in healthy or unhealthy ways. How consciously or unconsciously people exploit these needs for their own selfish benefit defines how good or evil the institution may be. As he says in a saying from the collection Sand and Foam, "Government is an agreement between you and myself. You and myself are often wrong." That is, Gibran did not recognize any ultimate authority outside the human soul and its direct relationship with God, a term that he cautions us not to use so casually, or with the presumption that we know what we are actually talking about. It were wiser to speak less of God, whom we cannot understand, and more of each other, whom we may understand. Yet I would have you know that we are the breath and the fragrance of God. We are God, in leaf, in flower, and oftentimes in fruit. His critiques of accepted institutions repeatedly led Gibran back to the essential question, how should one live? In trying to answer this, he returns to the paradox that plagued him throughout his life. If living a normal, simple life produced the most happiness, how does a sensitive person account for the feelings of alienation that separate him or her from those around them? How does one escape this inner exile? One of Gibran's solutions was to balance solitude with community life, time in spiritual retreat with the increasingly busy life he found in an early 20th century American city. His difficulty finding this balance can be seen in a selection from the book The Madman, entitled here, I Am Not What I Seem. It begins like this. My friend, I am not what I seem. Seeming is but a garment I wear, a care-woven garment that protects me from your questionings and from your negligence. The I in me, my friend, dwells in the house of silence, and therein it shall remain forevermore, unperceived, unapproachable. Resolving his inner alienations between Lebanese and American culture, between self and community, led Gibran to the major wisdom influences of his life, his Middle Eastern Christianity and Sufi mysticism. As I noted in the introductions to the earlier collections, Gibran was raised as a Maronite Christian, an Eastern church allied to the Roman Catholic, but that which, until the 18th century, spoke and used in liturgy, the Syriac language, related directly to Jesus' native Aramaic. The Aramaic-speaking churches historically view Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth, as a human being, a small s son of God, who uniquely fulfilled his destiny and expressed the divine life in a way open to all of us. In this sense, we could all become children of God, that is, of sacred unity, the literal translation of the Aramaic word for God, Allah, as well as the equivalent Arabic word, Allah. In his 1928 book, Jesus, the Son of Man, Gibran introduces us to various figures, biblical and fictional, who talk about the Jesus they knew. Echoing the above conviction about humanity's potential, the Apostle John says, Jesus, the Anointed, was the first word of God uttered unto humanity, even as if one apple tree in an orchard should bud and blossom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.